What's going on, guys? We're here. We're live. Welcome to a brand new Poker Life podcast. My name is Jose. Well, no, my name today is Joel Ingram 1, aka Chicago Joey. Joined today on the podcast by a young gentleman who is, you know, this guy's a fucking beast, man. I think I first saw him playing some of the high stakes cash games on Full Tilt, you know, back in the day when I was coming up in poker. And then I watched this documentary called Nosebleed. And none of it was in English, so you actually had to read subtitles the entire time when they finally translated it over. Now, that might seem not very enjoyable, but it's actually one of the most enjoyable poker documentaries I've ever seen, ever made. And it kind of followed him and his buddy Seb playing the high-stakes cash games and followed him in Vegas. And it was overall, it was just super well done. And we don't really get many French guys on here on the podcast. So I'm very happy to have this guy on. His name is Alex Luneau, a.k.a. Alex on Moon on Full Tilt, and Biatch People on Poker Stars. I believe that's how you say it, right? Biatch People, right?
Hey, guys. Yeah, you did right. Well done.
All right, Alex, welcome to the podcast, man. And you guys know we love French people on the podcast. So
this one. I hope you guys can understand my accent. I know it can be a bit hard for people at first. I've got a strong French accent, but.
Do people not have a don't all French people have a strong French accent, though?
Sorry?
Don't all French people have a pretty strong French accent?
Well, some are better than others, you know. But yeah, I guess for English speakers, we all sound having a strong accent, I guess.
Yeah, I'm kind of, you know, I've talked with Alex Dreyfus. Shout out to Alex Dreyfus. I know he's like the most hated guy in poker right now. Whatever, calm down, guys. But yeah, I talked with him, and so it makes it easier. But I feel like if you were the first French person I ever spoke to, I would have absolutely no idea what you're saying. It might be challenging for sure.
Yeah, you need practice.
So I kind of gave a little bit of what do people say about the audio? I kind of gave people a little bit of a rundown about you at the beginning. But so, are you still playing the high-stakes cash games, Alex? Or because I know you're sponsored by Winamax in France now.
Every day, mostly. Anything available in limit or mixed games online. That's still my main activity. I'm sponsored by Winamax, but it's still, I'm mainly still, high-stakes cash game player.
Yeah. What cash game, do high-stakes cash games run on Winamax?
Oh, no. I barely ever play on Winamax, only when I'm in France a little bit. My activity is still on PokerStars.
Oh, okay. All right.
There's no high-stakes on Winamax. The highest is like 10-20, so I don't play there almost.
No, yeah, because we talked about when you came on the podcast, you asked if I was sponsored by a poker site, and I said no.
Yeah, I wasn't sure.
Okay, yeah, because I wasn't sure if you could only play on Winamax or not. I'm like, I hope you can. I hope you can play on more than Winamax.
Yeah, I can do whatever I want. Yeah, it's totally fine. I mean, obviously, that's my main activity, so that wouldn't make sense for me to give up on all the high-stakes cash game for being sponsored by Winamax or anything.
I've heard of weirder things happening, but I was like, I can't believe that he would ever do that, but... You know, it just, I mean, are there, so you're playing, which cash games are you playing mainly now? Are you playing the mixed games?
What is mostly running lately has been the mixed game. I used to play a lot as well. The used to seven, used to run a lot, but now it's kind of dead. So, but I really play everything. Can be like Omaha Hilo, can be Horse, can be, they used to have 10 game on Full Tilt. So really anything that is running that is not No Limit or Piero almost.
So you don't play, you used to play No Limit and PLO only cash games.
Yeah, I used to play. I mean, I can play those games a bit. I'm just, don't think good enough to jump in those games. Like, the guys there are, like, I think much better than me, so I don't have a chance to win there. But yeah, it used to be my main game. When I first started mixed game, actually, I considered myself as a big bet specialist back in 2009. Mm-hmm. Yeah, first in No Limit of them and PLO.
Guys, we're live here on YouTube. We're live here on Twitch. If you have any questions or comments, put them in the chat. Please talk about his World Series of Poker final table this summer. Alex, man, so I actually met you at the series this summer. What were we playing? We're playing the one of the PLO events,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, a 3,000 PLO tournament, I think.
Oh, yeah, I think I busted you that turn. Shout out to me, man. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. How's the series this year for you, man? What was that like?
Not so good. So I've been playing almost every day, every 10K. I did like two final table, and that's about it. And like overall, like five cash, I think, which is like really average compared to the number of entries I've got. And doing a final table when you play the 10K event is not anything really special because you get like 120 entries. So being in the top is significant. So not so good. I was up in money because I wasn't paying the buy-in. Winamax was paying me the buy-in. So I ended up like up like 150K. But then I went, I was a bit bored of tournaments. So I went to play cash games. And I went in the Bobby's room and I put all the money on the table in the 15 3K mix game.
You got all the money?
Yeah, all the money I made in the tournament. I put it all on the table in the cash game at the Bobby's room. You know, you can buy quite deep in those games. So I put everything there and I lasted 3 days and I busted it. So that was my summer.
So, okay. I mean, I think there's a 75% chance you actually played 3 days in a row, but did you take a break in between the 3 days or did you just play three days straight?
Yeah, obviously I took breaks. Like I didn't play nonstop, but I did like, I don't know, 8 hour session each day or something like that.
I mean, I believe you played 3 days straight.
Yeah. It's very small. It's only like 50 big bets. So like, it's a very small swing actually to lose it or double it.
So why didn't you take more money, or was it just like, I'm up this amount of money, let's just play cash games?
That's all the cash I had. I didn't bring much cash in Vegas, so that's all I had based on my tournament winning. So, yeah, I was there. I was bored of tournaments, so I wanted to go back to play some cash games. So, yeah, I just jumped in the game. Really good game for me, those games in that front of Bobby's room. So, tournament because I got the sponsoring where I don't pay the buy-in, so it's even better value. But otherwise, all during the whole summer, you got games running in mixed game in the Bobby's room, a very good mix for me. So yeah, I think it's really value for me to play that. But yeah, I only did it at the end. It didn't work out very well. I didn't have much bankroll for that, unfortunately. But
yeah, it would seem like you especially, as a mixed game guy, that's what the bigger games are at Bellagio are running. Even at Aria was running a mixed game pretty often this year. So
yeah, but it was different mixed game. It was a big bet mix where I would be less confident. Like they had a lot of games I never played there. While the mix that was running in the Bobby was like all my best game almost. It was like an 11 game mix. And so it was similar to the 10 game they used to have on Full Tilt. So give you an idea, you got like Badugi, No Limit Sing and Draw, and all the classical of 8 games, so like stud games. No Limit, PLO, Milo, Limit of them. And they had it used to turn, right? So a really good mix for me, really.
Yeah, I would imagine that a lot of the games probably try to, like, I think I talked with Jason Mercy about this. A lot of the mixed games, they probably add in games that are unusual. So guys like yourself are at a disadvantage. Otherwise,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you'd be at a pretty big advantage playing all games.
The mix is good because what's annoying for me when I come usually in the summer, like if I play 4-8 or smaller limit, they usually play some weird mix and game I've never played in my life. Even though I can still get a feeling of what's going on because I played so many games and I have very good understanding of game theory and stuff, I get a feeling, but it's still frustrating to get there and like, okay, what's that game? Like Rez Ducey, Stodai Ludugi, or like some weird stuff where you... It can be fun, but I'd rather have a game where I know I'm really good at it, and so I know it's going to have the edge right now. So that's why that big mixed game in the Bobby's room was quite good.
No, that makes sense. I guess, yeah, if the game's already running or if it's been running all day, it's really kind of hard to just throw a random game in if it's six.
Yeah, that's the idea. They try to keep the same mix the whole summer so that people are more likely to come because it's always annoying. You know, you've been playing for like 3 days a big game in the mix, and then, oh, no, they just shank five on the game. So they really try to keep constant all the games during the whole summer in the big game in the Bobby's room.
No, that makes sense. Who's playing in that game mainly? Anyone that the people out there might know?
Yeah, of course, yeah. Well, you had all the big online guys who play mixed game over there. So you had like Michael Turitz, you had Sauce, you had Elior was there. Yeah, and some big name like Antonius, Oppenheim, Ivy. I'm probably missing some of the names. Like, yeah, like all the big names that you know. And yeah, there's a lot of pro there. And you even have some amateurs coming once in a while. So the game is quite good.
It's interesting. So pretty tough spot because, as you mentioned, Winamax, That's a really tough spot. So Winamax puts you in these tournaments.
Yeah.
How do you not play the tournaments, right? I mean, yeah, it's like you can't.
I did play all the tournaments, yeah, but for me it's good, you know, because I don't play the buy-in, so it's still a very good EV, you know, playing all the tournaments. Also, you know, I play cash game all year long, so I'm kind of happy to do. Even though I'm not a tournament player, I enjoy a bit once in a while a bit of competition that you get in the tournament. So, first for the money, even for the pleasure out of it, you know, it's kind of interesting to get. I mean, I didn't get to win a tournament, but it's quite unique when you do a deep run. The feeling you get from that is quite special. So even though I might be losing some EV somewhere by not playing all summer those big games, it's still very enjoyable, at least at the beginning. By the end, I was quite burnt out as always. But yeah, it's quite a lot of fun.
Dude, when I saw you, you're sitting on my left. I'm like, yeah. Mike, you're very quiet. You're not saying anything. You look like you would play a lot of poker. I'm like, who's this French? I'm like, he looks familiar. I just don't know who he is. But then I started talking with you and we were chatting a little bit and I was like, yeah, I know how you feel. Like, cause I felt that way like 10 days in that I looked the same exact way. People are looking at me like, dude, you've been playing a lot of poker, right? I'm like, yeah, man. I'm like just tired. I'm like, I got nothing to say anymore.
And you only done 10 days. I've been there for months and a half, like, you know, and playing every day. Like, really, when you start busting, it adds up to your mind. So, yeah, it's heavy.
Yeah, man. You know what? I mean, like, you know, people say being a tournament player is hard. I agree. I'm not saying it's not hard, guys. I think it is hard. But it's also, like, not fun. That's not, like, you go to the Rio every single day, 11 a.m., you play 12 hours and you make a day two and then you come back, you bust 2 hours in and you're like, oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the thing with tournament. You're never happy unless you win it. You're always going to have some frustration somewhere, so unless you win it. But yet, when you're in the deep run, it's also a very nice special feeling as well. That is quite unique. I mean, I never get that feeling in cash game. Even though I have played huge games, having massive swing, it's not as intense as doing a final table. And that's quite unique in that sense, I think.
Yeah.
Have you ever done a final table?
What do you say?
Have you ever done a final table?
Let's see. I played my second tournament this summer, and that was the six max PLO. I don't remember what I got now. They're 30th or 38th or some shit like that. And that was I made a final table at the local card room with all the old people. There's this old. I brought my stepdad at the time. I brought my stepdad currently to the VFW. There's 80 people tournament and I end up winning that. So that's my final table experience. But yeah, I really haven't played any other tournaments outside of the summer of the series. That
also, you're playing the most boring game, I think, for tournaments is PLO. It's so frustrating when you come from a cash game background to play tournament in PLO because the ICM strategy, you must be playing so tight and it's so boring. You know, when you play from cash game background, it's so frustrating to, you know, have to get away from so many spots that you would normally take. It's such a nitty game in tournaments. It's not great to play.
Yeah, especially when you go deeper and you get really shallow. I mean, that's kind of what I notice is that when you're deeper effective, it's a lot of fun because now you can open a lot of hands and it's still kind of boring because it's a very, you know, you're like 2.1xing pre and then you're c-betting like 35% or some shit like that. And it's very boring tournament PLO, but it's kind of like a new challenge. You know, I'm so used to playing this one version of the game, so it's kind of fun to figure out this other version.
You know, a great game for tournament is a No Limit Single Draw.
Yeah, I've heard about this, but I never played. I mean, I know Single Draw, Triple Draw. These are your games, but I've never actually played the game.
It's amazing for tournament, No Limit Single Draw, especially in live, because it plays very fast, and you can be all in quite easily, and it's such a good live tournament game. Like there's a lot of action and you should give it a try. It's quite unique for tournament, I think. It's not as popular as it should be, I think.
No Limit Hold'em Single Draw Tournament.
No Limit Deuce to Seven Single Draw.
Aren't you like the Deuce to Seven like ambassador for the world? Aren't you the guy who is trying to get everybody to play the game because that would be good?
Yeah, well, the game is not as running as much this day, but yeah, that would be great. But yeah, it used to be, but now the game is kind of dying, I think.
Yeah, guys in chat, we got a lot of comments out there today. Welcome, guys, for the live stream today. Yeah, Kobe had this question. This is kind of something I was wondering. We touched on it briefly, but Which games is Alex playing these days? Yeah, you, so you mentioned you are playing the 8-game primarily on PokerStars. That's your main game.
What have you been playing lately? For example, the 2-4, 1-2, and 4-8 mix game, 8-game on Stars. Yeah, that's been the main thing. Not much juice to 7. Every game I kind of dead lately. A bit of 300, 600, 8. We actually had Gus who came back a few weeks ago. He played for like 2 days, 300, 600 on my ILO. So.
Oh, yeah. How'd that go?
Sometimes people come back. You think they will never come back, and they come back.
All right, let's talk about this. So, Nosebleed, you're on this documentary, right? And man, it's so good. It's so good. But you're kind of, I mean, how do you think Gus Hansen feels watching that documentary?
Yeah, I felt it probably didn't feel great. And I actually tried to contact him just before the release of the documentary. I did it on Skype and tried, but he wasn't answering me much. So, just let it go. But yeah, obviously, we come out as quite harsh on him. Documentary, the idea was to give a real picture of what's going on. You know, like the guy who did the documentary, Victor, he was following us all the time. So at the end, we almost forgot about the camera. And it was about showing the reality of how we are day to day. You know, there was no fake or anything. And we've been okay. Yeah, it's not great for Gus to speak about him like that in a public documentary. But the idea was just to show the reality of how we are in day to day. And I'm sure we're not the only one to be, you know, kind of people who we play regularly. But again, it's just based on his poker skills. I mean, I'm sure he's an amazing person. I never met him properly, but he seems to be a great guy. Like we're just talking poker wise. That yeah, we have running joke about him poker wise. But I mean, he's been such a a center for all the game for so many years. Like, people maybe don't realize from the outside, but what's so amazing about Gus games is it's not really about how good or bad Gus. It's about when Gus shows up, he fires like 6 tables in the same time, and he plays for 13 hours straight in a row. Yeah, a guy like that doing that, it attracts as well so many bad regulars who wants to play in the game. So you end up with like amazing game who lasts for days just because Gus is here. So it's not even the bad team, it's about as well all the environment that Gus creates. Nobody, the bad player usually when they come, they play maybe 1 table, a little hour, and they come. No, Gus, it's 6 tables, 10 hours in a row. That's what Gus does.
It sounds like Gus was really good for the action for a long time for you guys then.
That was amazing. Yeah. Again, not only he was attracting so many people around him as well, so many regulars, or even people who were worse than him would take a shot or maybe barely play the game and just jump in just to 7 game because they saw Gus Hansen. So, yeah, actually, you know, Gus win rate, I never look at it, but it's probably not even that bad, his lose rate, if you look at how many hands he played overall in his career online, because he plays so many hands. So he's losing, obviously, but it's not as bad as people would think.
That makes sense. I mean, yeah, it's like you're competing at the highest stakes against some of the best players in the world at their variation of the game. It's going to be very hard to compete with those guys typically.
Yeah, and also especially never gives himself the best chance to win because as I said, he's going to play so many tables at the same time, more than we do. When he's stuck, he can play on almost 24 hours in a row. I mean, that's not going to help.
Ah, man, yeah, I agree. Probably not smart to be playing. Yeah, especially when you're playing that high stakes against specialists who are playing 2 tables and focusing on every decision, and you're playing for 13, 14 hours on 5 or 6 tables.
Yeah, and if he doesn't have enough, sometimes he fires a pot limit on my table on the side, you know, just to gamble a bit.
I love Gus. So Gus is back. He's back playing a little bit of the mixed games.
No, I mean, he was just there for like 1 day. I think he just got some money from someone online and he just played a bit for like 5 hours and then I think he went busto and that's about it.
What's he up to these days? Is he living in some Monaco castle and being Gus Hansen? I mean, what's he kind of doing?
Last rumor I heard was kind of weird. They said he was now an event planner, but that seems a bit weird. So I don't know. Yeah,
like
event
like planner. Plans events.
Yeah, I don't know what that does that mean. I don't know.
We need to find Gus, get him on the podcast. We got to figure out about these events he's been planning. So,
he's been playing at the Bobby's Room as well this summer. Like after I was gone, but after the World Series, he's been playing a bit.
Yeah, I saw Daniel Granado posted some photo with Gus Hansen looking like a porn star from the 70s or 80s. You kind of got a little porn star from the 90s, 80s look going to you.
Sorry?
You don't think so with that hair, huh? And that hair and the facial hair?
Yeah, maybe.
Man, I'm trying. Like I said, I'm trying to get hair like that. You said you can grow that hair in 1 year?
No, I don't even know. I don't know. I don't track it. But I don't think it's been that long. Like, yeah, a year and a half maybe. I always had kind of longer. I mean, like you saw in the documentary, the same kind of lens. And I had that lens for many years. And just over the last years, that I kind of stopped. I've let it grow a bit. But
man, I want to get my – that's like one of my goals in my am I kidding or am I serious? I think that's one of my goals. I want to get some hair like that, but I'm like 2-5 years away, like I said. It's just not going to be able to work. So I don't know if it's like a...
No, it's not that long. You know, it's 1 year and a half, I think.
Yeah, but you go to that... I don't know. Whatever, man. People in the chat saying they've been spotting Gus Hansen playing 10-20 Zoom PLO, VPIPing 60 and 3-betting 25%.
Yeah, well, he always liked to play loose, you know. In every single game I've played with him, I play with him in every game, and he loves to play loose, yeah, no matter what's the game, you know. He's going to be more creative than anyone. Playing hands you would never think you could play, he's going to play.
Got to be balanced, right? I mean, listen, when you're playing, especially when you're playing a great game like Potlum and Omaha, you want to keep him guessing.
I mean, Riffrop is more balanced than anyone. He has all his range everywhere.
Yeah. if it's a 4-bet pot and the board's 3-3-4, he's got a lot more 3-4 in his range than you're going to think.
Yeah. You can't exploit him on
the So I guess from the documentary getting made, did anything happen from that? Did you get a lot more recognition from people when you're playing live poker, or did you get any backlash from anybody, or what was the reaction to that?
I wasn't in Vegas the year after the documentary, but that was this summer, and yeah, now a lot of people know me or recognize me, and yeah, for sure, before, apart from the French community, nobody would know me internationally. But yeah, now, yeah, I guess more people recognize me now.
Was there any downside to being on there, you think?
No, not really, no. I mean, I used to always be a bit scared about being well-known, just for, like, I thought it could kill your action somehow. But really, I've been in the high stakes for so long anyway that I thought it would not make much difference. So no, it's all good. Only good.
Yeah, I think
guess that's getting the sponsorship as well with Winamax, so it's good.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. I think most people are, yeah, like you said, scared to kill their action or something. Like, they don't want people to know sometimes who's behind the screen name, because then maybe they won't play them. But I feel like it might work the opposite way in some ways, especially if you play a game that doesn't have that many players playing it. Well, now people might watch the documentary and be like, well, maybe I'll try that game, or maybe I'll try these mixed games, or I'll play some of these games I've never played before, because I just watched this for an hour and a half and now I want to go try it.
Have you ever tried any of those variants? Have you ever tried anything but Piero?
I played No Limit for a while, but no, I love I just play the great game of Palo in Omaha.
Oh, come on, you should try something new, you know? How many years you've been playing? Are you not bored?
I mean, you know you get four. How can you get bored? You get... Listen, I will never be bored playing.
How many cards do you think you have in other games? You got 5 or 7 cards.
That's too many. What do you need that many cards for, Alex? 5 cards, 7? What do you need 7 fucking cards for? It's like overwhelming a little bit.
No, it's not. It's different.
No.
You know, it keeps your brain stimulated. You think about different stuff. It's fun.
If I'm not gonna play 4-card, I'm gonna go play basketball. You know, I'm gonna go shoot some hoops on my hoop, and I'm gonna go work on my footwork over here. I'm gonna go dance or something. I don't know.
How come you started Piero with such a mentality? I'm sure it was very hard for you to transition from No Limit Hold'em to Piero. No, I'm sure you were like, oh no, come on, 4-card is too much. I like 2-cards.
No, because when I played 2-card, when I switched from 2-card to 4-card. I wanted to get Supernova Elite, and it was going to be much, much easier to get it at PLO. So I didn't care what the game was. I was like, I just need these BBPs. I don't care how much I lose. I just need to get Supernova Elite. So that was kind of why I switched over to the game initially.
Right.
So, and I was always kind of, I was always pretty spewy as well too. So PLO kind of works for you because you never have to fold a three bet. And I hated folding the three bets. You don't have to fold the three bets in PLO. It's
Yeah, I'm so spewy in PLO. That's my worst game. I spew so much in that. It's terrible. I can't help.
I noticed you do like to play a lot of hands. Yeah.
Yeah.
One observation I noticed, I was like, oh, this guy, I like this guy. He likes to put money in the pot pre-flop. I'm a fan of that.
I'm French, you know, like French people, they don't like to fold much, you know.
God, I miss the French people. I remember when PokerStars took the French people away and took the Italians away, took the Spanish away. Oh my God.
Yeah, that was a sad day for poker community. Like, yeah, that's how it is, really. I don't know why. This must be a thing. Whenever the further south you go in the world, the worse people get. Like, if you look at all the, like at Brazil, Italy, Spain, France, we all suck at poker, really, in average. And if you look at all the Scandinavian country, England, the US, you guys are all good. Like, German are good. Why is that? Is it the temperament?
Listen, I don't want to say it, but you know, now that you went there, I'm gonna go there too. So you're right. The French people are pretty bad at poker. I mean, the Brazilians are bad. The Americans are fucking terrible. I mean, like, I really don't get it. I don't understand that. That's a really good question, because why are?
I think that might be an ego thing. Like in the south of France or in Italy or Spain, there's more ego in place, you know, and that's not a good thing to have in poker, to get angry over things, to get impatient, and all of that doesn't help probably. And they think maybe less rationally compared to like the German guy, like you picture very rational and studious. I think that might be a bit of that.
That's a really good point, because so what other countries, I guess, are like Belarus, you know, what other country? I guess all like the Eastern European countries.
Russia used to be so bad. Now they are everywhere great. But when I started in 2008, like whenever you see a Russian icon, it has to be a huge wave. Now they are good. They used to be so bad. Like
some of the worst fun players of all time were the Russian guy. Scout? Was Scout from Russia?
Yeah, he was. Yeah.
God, what a fucking legend, Scout 326. God, one of the. The initial reason I ever shot to a guy takes no limit was because of Scout. God, I think he still
played 3-6. I think so many people did.
See, he's another guy. Like, basically, because of a guy like Scout 326 playing no limit hold'em, so many people like myself who should never have been playing 10, 20, or 25, 50 played those games. Therefore, the better regulars, like the versions of yourself playing no limit, are just like, God, this is amazing. You got these terrible fucking players playing 25, 50.
That's why it's so great for action when you get a bad player. It just, for all the world economy, it gets crazy because, it gives action everywhere. It's amazing.
Are there any guys like that sort of still existing right now in the mixed game community?
Well, we still have some guys who come from time to time. Jean Robert gives a lot of action when he's there. He hasn't been playing for a while, but it's always good action. Everybody, like girls, they love to take shots at him.
Mm.
Yeah, there might be other guys I'm not thinking of, but we got also often got, like, we never know who really they are, but sometimes we get some weird account. We are probably multi-account from, like, some American pro who might not be that good, who are trying to multi-account and play. And so, yeah, you got those guys. But the action is not as good as it used to be, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of a natural progress because all the country segregation now, you know, people... Just PokerStars in general, the overall sentiment to PokerStars isn't as positive as it once was. And I think there are probably a lot of different reasons why the action kind of keeps getting worse and worse.
Yeah. Even though I feel at least in my games, it's still it's kind of the last stronghold, like in poker. Like it looks like No Limit and Pot Limit Omaha are really dead, but at least mixed game, I'm still lucky for that, fortunate for that. But yeah, more people should try. You know, it's great mixed game. We're still very far from having solving any games. You know, like there's still so much room. Like I would consider myself to one of the best all around limit player, but I still make mistakes all the time. You know, like all the time I make stupid mistakes. Like nobody plays studs game very well. I think nobody's great at it. Nobody's great at Omaha. Like there's still so much room to improve. So it feels like compared to No Limit Hold'em, where everybody's like so close to perfect, there's lot of room in the mixed game.
Yeah, I think that's like the good and bad thing about playing mixed games is that there are so many games you go play, and if you're used to Hold'em, now you're great at this one game, and now you got to get better at what, 5, 6 other games. So it's a very intimidating thing. And then also, when you think about the stakes being involved, there's just really not many tables to choose from often. So when you're trying to learn, like, you don't really
You have to start at high stakes, kind of. I mean, it's hard to, I don't look at the lobby, but I don't think it runs much at mid small stakes. So yeah, you have to play high straight away almost.
Right.
But it's just, yeah, also a lot of fun. I think for anyone who tried, like, having this, when you play an easy game, you switch game every 8 hands or 6 hands or 10 hands. So you don't have time to get bored. You're like, oh, okay, no limit all them's over, now it's Piero. Boom. Oh, okay, now a bit of limit all them. Now it's a stud game. And that always keeps you a bit excited, you know. It's I don't know. Whenever now I go back to playing one game straight, it seems so boring, you know.
I've never felt that way playing PLO. I mean, I'm always excited.
You can't have a good view of it because you haven't tried anything else, you know.
That's true. I mean, yeah, I was going to make a comparison there, so PokerStars just announced new changes in the VIP rewards 2017, Julian says. I have not seen these changes. Have you seen these changes, Alex?
No, I don't follow much what's happening with the changes. I mean, I know I don't have Rakeback anymore, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know what the changes are. You guys in the chat can tell me. Tell me what the changes are. That'd be awesome. Let me see. Joey, ask him if he still boxes. Yeah, you a boxer, Alex?
Yeah, I've done boxing for many years, for like 5 years, but I got a bad injury in my eye, so yeah, I had to stop. So now I'm more into rock climbing.
Do you enjoy bouldering, or do you enjoy the one where
bouldering. I love bouldering. It's really amazing. I'm really addicted. I go there like 2-3 times a week. It's really good.
Yeah, I was addicted to rock climbing for a little bit, but then I kind of went back to basketball because basketball is a little more physical. You can punish people a little bit. Rock climbing's kind of you versus the wall, and it's still really fun.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, that's one of the downsides. You're not competing straight in front of someone. There's not like one-to-one, you know, fight, or like I had in boxing, which I love, inspiring. You don't have that, but there's also other positive point. You know, like you can really track your progress a lot, which is a nice thing. You know, like in some sports, you can feel like for 6 months you don't improve or you don't know what's happening. Well, here it's clear. Like you go, oh, I've done this, I've done that, I've done. You know, it's very clear. So you get more often the reward feeling. You know, you feel good about yourself more often, I think, in the bouldering.
Yeah, I kind of looked at it as a one-on-one challenge. It's like a heads-up match where you need to beat the wall and you need to figure out how you can beat the wall, where the rocks, where the ball's weaknesses are, where your weaknesses are, how you can take advantage of your weaknesses against the wall. This is how I was looking at rock climbing. I'm like, I'm not sure if this is how most people look at this stuff, but...
Yeah, that's the way to see it. Yeah, yeah, you challenge yourself against the wall, yeah. But you can still compare yourself to other people in some way. You can be like, okay, like, all those guys here, they can't do that one, or this guy did that, I tried to do it as well. You know, you can still compare yourself. You will never be as good as a sport where you're competing in one-to-one, but it still can be very enjoyable.
Yeah. Fine in the chat says, basically, Stars is going to kill online poker with these new changes. You can get your VIP status up by betting on casino and sports.
Yeah, that's funny.
Interesting.
Well, I think it's good. Like, it's good for... Maybe some, I'm sure many recreationals spend a lot of time on the casino already anyway. And so if they can get a better status, why not, you know?
Why not?
They will have more Rakeback when they play the poker game. I don't know. Maybe that's not.
Why not? Why not? Poppy, can you ask him about his match with John Smith? So was this a heads-up match for the bracelet this summer?
Oh, yeah, that was a sad thing. Yeah, I ended up in the semifinal in the 10K heads-up against John Smith. And I think I played my worst heads up of my life there against him. But basically, the crazy thing, do you see who is John Smith? You have to Google him first.
He's probably some old guy, right?
Yeah, no, not old, very old. He looks like 80 years old. And he's 80 years old, actually. And that guy was the biggest maniac I've ever seen. And I thought, getting in the match, like some people told me, oh, he's a massive nit, he never bluffs, you know, always show papers, always have good hands. And yet, it happens that he was bluffing me every single hand. And me, I was like, okay, that guy is 80 years old. He must have it again. I fall. So I kept folding the whole match, and he's been bluffing me the whole match. So I've been totally owned by an 80 years old guy in the semifinal. That was kind of painful looking back at it. But It's always hard to guess that someone so old. Like, if you take a population of poker player of his age, most of them are so passive and tight and don't run a big bluff ever. And that guy was nonstop bluffing. So.
Yeah, I think when I saw I showed the list of who was left, I was like, oh, well, there's no chance this old guy wins. And then I looked, I was like, wait, how did he win? Like, what the fuck? I was like, wait, this guy's like...
He hasn't even been lucky. He really killed me. That was really painful.
Jesus, man. It's so... So what was the buy-in for that one? Was it the 10K heads up?
Yeah, 10K, yeah.
That hurts.
Yeah, that's fun to play. Heads up is really fun to play live, but it's quite fast. Because usually what's annoying about playing live, at least for me, it's very slow and it's boring. But at least when you play heads up, you get to play many hands, so it's quite cool.
Yeah, that's kind of why I like shorthanded live poker, because you get to play so many hands. It's so much fun. I mean, it's really a lot of fun, but then when it goes back to being a full game after it's shorthanded, it's probably one of the worst feelings in playing live poker.
Yeah.
You know, it's like you go from being able to play 50% of your hands to you got to fold for a long time. So
that's not terrible, very fun.
Kit, you recently you recently got married, didn't you?
Yeah, just like 2 weeks ago. Yeah,
that
was strong. You know, I never thought it would be so intense. That was amazing day.
So, marriage, huh? How long you been dating your wife now for?
5 years.
5 years. So you met her.
It was in the documentary you saw in Nosebleed.
Oh yeah. Okay. So you met her in 2011. So when you meet her, you're still playing. You're basically already having these $1 million swings, and you're playing some of the high stakes.
Yeah.
So when you meet her, what's that conversation like?
Well, I usually don't talk much about poker or what I'm doing. I usually try to stay away from that because it can influence the relationship at first, you know. So I usually try to keep it quiet and be more normal. I will obviously say fairly soon that I'm a poker player, but I will not mention all the swings I have because I don't think it's very healthy. I mean, it might not be a problem, but in some cases it could have been not healthy. So I usually try to avoid speaking about those big swings. And even day to day, anyway, like even now, like she knows obviously what I'm playing. I usually don't mention it much because there's not much point really. So no, I don't talk much about it.
Yeah, I think. I mean, do you wish you could talk to her about it? Do you wish that you could mention the swings that you have?
I'm okay with it. You know, I've been playing for so long. Like it's okay. I deal with the swing pretty well, I think. So no, I don't have this need to tell people about my bad beat or my downswing. It's all right.
Yeah, I found that with some, you know, sometimes when you date people in the past and you're like, oh yeah, you know, I had a 20K day. I don't know. Nothing good comes from that. Nothing good comes from you telling someone you had a 20K day or
exactly,
a 20K day.
Like,
the conversation never goes well. Yeah, it just always goes somewhere a little weird, a little strange, makes the dynamic a little strange.
Yeah.
So, man, married now. So when you, I'm curious about this because when you meet her, and then you guys start talking about poker, and then she, like, you know, you tell her a little bit more. Like, what's her reaction to that? Because you're having these, like, massive swings. You're making, you know, poker's like this really weird thing when you say, yeah, I play these highest stakes poker, and I'm gambling for millions of dollars.
Well, first, I don't say that. I don't say I play high stakes poker for millions of dollars. I just say I'm a poker player, and I talk more about the part which is more interesting and that people can relate to, so the traveling. The expense in casino, or you know, my lifestyle. At the time, I used to live in Thailand, or you know, being in Macau, like more this kind of thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to talk about money, I think, especially because in the poker it's so extreme. You know, the swing we have also doesn't relate necessarily to the amount of money we have. I mean, I think the swing are always a different thing, so I don't think it's easy for people outside poker to understand it and to deal with it. So I think, yeah, I usually rather don't speak about swings.
Yeah, I think it's pretty, it's very, very, very challenging for the general person to have any idea of exactly what it means to go through these like massive swings up and down. So it's, what is this comment? All right, I keep getting this comment about hair. Let me. What is this comment about the hair? Someone had lost their hair. A French guy lost their hair. Oh no!
Massive swings up and down.
Poppy, have we spotted? We have spotted some hair on Julian.
Comment about hair. What is this comment about the hair?
There's a lag.
Someone had lost their hair. A French guy lost their hair. Oh no!
Yes, in the lag.
Poppy, have you thought about it?
Maybe wow, the lag's bad. Am I? Can you turn the speakers down a little bit?
There's an echo now. There's an echo. It's kind of weird.
Oh no. Ah. The echo's taking over. Guys, we're live. Sometimes things happen. Hold on a second. Here, Alex, come go out of the chat and then come back into it. All right, he muted himself.
Sorry.
All right, now we're
sorry,
back.
Sorry, I got it.
All right, we're good now. The lag was the sometimes when we're yeah, okay, guys, then chat. Sometimes when we lag, the feedback is real. I know. Yeah, so who's this French guy? Julien Labrousse. Fuck, I don't want to say his fucking goddamn names. Julien Labrousse.
I don't know. Maybe he wrote it down because I don't know. Like Julien?
He must be a joke. Never mind. It's a troll. I thought it was a serious question. I don't know. Never mind. Yeah. I can't even answer that one. So, all right, let's get into this, man. So, So I guess, so your plan right now, what's your, you know, WCOOP's happening right now. We got the 100K happening on Sunday. We got a lot of high stakes cash games. We got a lot of PLO. Well, you don't play the PLO or no limit that I've been running. So what's sort of your plan for the WCOOP? Is it play as much poker as you possibly can?
Yeah, it's usually quite good in the WCOOP for us mixed game player because a lot of tournament players, they all, you know, at the moment, some of the American guys go to Mexico or whatever to play, and usually they end up, you know, when they get bored a bit, they go play a bit in our mixed game. And yeah, they usually don't play perfect, so they usually create action around them. So yeah, it's usually good action for mixed game during WCOOP. And also, they got a 10K game as a tournament, so that should be some action. And yeah, otherwise, I don't know. You know, you never know in mixed game. It's a day-to-day thing. So
are you going to play the 100K, the 102K or something like that?
I'm not a tournament player. Like, I don't think I'm that great at no limit, so I will not play it, no.
No. What do you think about I think Jason Mercier is going to be streaming the event, showing his cards. What do you think about that idea?
Well, as long as I guess obviously there will be like a 30-minute delay or something, but I think it's fine. It's to show their cards. Like, it's not like anyone gonna, you know, poker player are lazy. It's not like his opponent that he plays usually in super high roller. They're all gonna take notes and watch him, and I'm sure anyway, like he mixes up his play a lot. So I think it's fine. Like, I don't think anyone would take advantage of that much, especially these days. No limit. Then there's not. I doubt he has a very crazy exploitive style, or he will not surprise anyone with his plays. Like. Yeah, I don't think that's much of a big deal. It's like, you know, everybody can watch Source video or whatever guys make video. It's not like they're going to take advantage of that and crush them based on that. I mean, maybe they could if they do very hard work and try to spot on everything, but usually I very doubt anyone would do it. Like, anyone's going to play him heads up. You know, it's the odds that they find him on the same table and stuff. It's just, yeah, I think it's good for the game and it won't cost him anything, so it's probably a very good idea.
Yeah, I think it will be pretty good for the games. I mean, it's like anytime you have someone that's going to stream a $100,000 tournament, even though, I mean, to me, a $100,000 tournament, it's pretty much the same thing as any other tournament. Like, all the tournaments are kind of the same when I look at a tournament now. So I don't really get that excited about it, but I can understand why people are getting pretty excited about it.
Yeah, it's probably going to be very tough. I can imagine all the top No Limit or them pro going to play that. So, yeah.
Yeah, the field is not looking very very soft, let's put it like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, usually when you play live, the big high roller, you always have like some very soft player in there, at least 10% fish or something. And I doubt you're gonna get that in that high roller. So yeah, should be fairly tough.
Yeah, I guess it should be interesting. So you got the 10K mixed game, you got all the mixed games that are running. So outside of WCOOP, you know, I mean, how else are you spending your time? You got your wife, you're living in London, I believe, right?
Yeah, I'm in London, yeah.
So what else do you spend your time doing besides playing online?
A bit of traveling lately. I got a villa in Italy while I'm still doing some work there and enjoying myself as well there. Also spending some time in Paris. I'm actually going next week we're shooting a documentary there. I can't say much about it, but this will be more a mainstream documentary. Yeah, I often have stuff to do with Winamax as well sometimes, you know, like some like podcasts like here or different kind of stuff. And but yeah, otherwise I spend a lot of time bouldering. You know, as I said, it's really took the passion there. So actually, have you ever tried, you've been doing bouldering in the past, yeah?
Yeah.
Have you ever tried deep water soloing?
Deep water what?
Soloing. It's like when you do bouldering or climbing, but you do that over the water, so you don't need any protection or anything because you're climbing the rocks just above the water. So whenever you fall, you have the water nearby. So
I've seen competitions where they put them above water, and I was like, I don't know if I want to drop in the water, but yeah, that would be. They go up really fucking high, so that'd be fun.
Yeah, it's really fun because you get like a lot of freedom there, and it's really special, like just swimming around, climbing rocks, and yeah, like you can fall no problem. So it's very, very nice.
Do you ever go outside, like on the actual hardcore sort of bouldering places, or are you kind of just go into man-made bouldering spots?
Okay. You see?
Yeah.
Wait a second.
Oh. Hey, there.
Hello.
Oh God, it's just my giant legs. Hello. Oh, yes,
welcome to the podcast. Welcome to the live stream.
Thank you. Oh God, it's so. You can see my crazy legs. Yeah. So I've got. It's really awkward. Hello. Anyway, I'll leave.
Oh yeah.
nice to meet you.
Hi.
You might recognize her from Nosebleed.
You have a different accent. Where are you from?
From London. I probably featured about 5 minutes in it, so well, not even 5 minutes, probably like 2 minutes. So. I'm from London.
You're from London. Are you 6 feet tall?
No, not far off. I'm like 5'10", so it's quite tall. The same height as Alex, so it's all good.
Okay, I'm going to ask you one, I just want to ask you one question or two questions for the people of the podcast, because we don't often get now you're officially a wife. Congratulations, by the way. I saw the pictures on Facebook. You guys looked awesome, and he still has the sick hair even in the dress outfit. So it's,
yeah,
it's
I like his hair. It's pretty cool.
So during this time of WCOOP, when he's playing a lot of poker online, because so many people are playing, do you like that or do you not like it?
So when he's playing how, sorry?
When he's playing a lot of hours playing poker online.
Oh, no, it's great. No, it's cool. I mean, as long as he's having a good time, it's great. Like it's fun for him as well. It gives him something different to do, I suppose, than just, I don't know, what do you normally do? No, it's good. He enjoys it, so yeah, it's fun. Like, yeah, it's cool. We have a lot of time together anyway, so like, you know, it's good that he can go off and do his thing, and then I can go and do my thing, and then we meet whenever, and yeah, it's good.
You guys meet and just look at each other's hair and play with each other's hair, and you're like, man, you've got nice hair, and then
I sometimes disturb him and come and bring him a cup of tea, you know.
Yeah, I've got a lot of support when I play.
Yeah, no, I like that. It's good. It's funny. Yeah.
All right. We've all decided we're all going to get English women now. We're all getting an English wife, guys. I'm moving to London. I'm out of Chicago.
English women. It's all about English women, guys. Come on.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay. I'm going to leave you now.
Hey, thank you for coming on.
Nice to meet you.
It was nice meeting you as well.
No worries. Yeah, I'm going to go into the pub now and have a drink. So, bye.
See you later.
See ya.
Adios. Mount says, what's your complex about hair? Listen, I don't have a complex about hair, but they both got nice fucking hair. You know, you got to call it like you see it, buddy. Come on, man. Papi! Papi! Got the wife over there, huh? Yeah,
she doesn't know what WCOOP is. I never told her, so the question was a bit weird.
Oh, okay. She doesn't know what WCOOP means.
Yeah, I mean, I don't speak about my poker stuff much more, almost never, so she will not know.
What are you guys, what are you talking about? What do you guys, you know, what's sort of your conversations?
I don't know. Anything but poker, I guess. But Whatever, I don't know. I don't have anything in mind, but what did you talk about with your girlfriend? You told them about your poker story?
I wish they liked, I wish they were into the podcast. I wish I could, I mean, I still, I kind of, like, it would be fun if I could talk about, hey, like some podcast strategy or some creative strategy or even poker or poker mindset stuff. But often I find that I can't talk about those things with most of the women I meet. So that's the question, right? Like, what do you, I don't know. Like, we talk about, it seems like, you know, very boring things to me, very boring things. That's what we talk about.
Poker is a really boring thing to speak when someone doesn't know much about it anyway. And also, when I spend so much time playing already, when I'm with her, I want to quit that environment. I'm happy to speak about or do something different. You know, I don't want to come up with poker-related stuff. Like, that would be silly.
Yeah. Remy says, you don't talk about your day job when you get home, no matter what, no matter what job. I mean, I don't think it has to be like that. I don't think it has to be like that. I mean, I don't know, especially if what you do is something that you're extremely passionate about. It's not really like a job where you just kind of go to work and then you come home. And like for poker, for me, I love playing. I love thinking about it. I love trying to get better at it. I love thinking about it more and talking about it more. Even not even just the strategy, just the mindset of it, the approach of it, recovering from upswings.
You want a break, no? I mean, I love, I'm really obsessed with poker, but it's nice to have a break as well, to lose yourself in something else.
I wish I liked a break. I wish I did. I mean, I'm like jealous. I'm really jealous of people that can turn it off, because that's always been one of my biggest challenges.
Sure. It always takes a little transition. If I spend like 7 hours playing all day, I can't just quit and be normal. I need like a little transition, or I need maybe a bit of alcohol. I can't just go straight and be normal. I'm still going to be in my bubble, you know?
Yeah. Rupert says, Alex, make jokes about make jokes about Gus.
Make joke about Gus. Actually, you know, Gus is very funny, you know. If you look up all the chat logs, he's so funny in the chat. He always has some very good comments.
Do you have a favorite Gus Hansen story that comes to mind?
I have one, but you have to understand Deuce to Seven to get it, but I can try. That was in the Deuce to Seven game. He was in the big blind. I'm in the small blind. He told folds up to me. I open. He called. I drew maybe whatever, 2-3 cards. And then he takes his time and he types in the chat, Monaco's special. And he changed all his cards, which is something you never do in Deuce to Seven. I mean, and he did that at 2K, 4K, which is really like, I mean, yeah, it's like just like, get 1,000, you know, it's like Monaco Special was giving me $1,000 or something, maybe. Just like, but again, you have to understand Deuce to Seven to get the, how silly that is. But.
So Deuce to Seven, is this a 3-draw or 1-draw game?
It's a 3-draw game, at least the triple draw version, where you start with 5 cards and you get to change as many cards as you want. And you have 3 shot to change.
So wait a second, let me think about it. You get to change cards in this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so triple draw, I get to change cards. 3 draws, potentially change 3, 4, 5, 6 cards. So it could be an 11-card game, huh?
Draw. Yeah, I don't know. Well, you know what happens sometimes in live game when the game is really good? You even get to reshuffle the deck. Because you give away so many cards, people change so many times the cards, that you have to, with all the dead cards, the cards that people throw away, you reshuffle it to give them cards. Because look, let's say there's 6 players at the table. There's 30 cards where are like dealt. Uh-huh. And then there's only 22 cards left in the deck, right? So if people keep changing cards a lot everywhere, at some point there won't be any card left. So what you do, for all the cards that has been discarded, they all put together and they have to reshuffle the deck to give a card.
I'm in, man. It sounds fun. Wait a second. Yeah. This game sounds fun. Wait a second. Okay, so wait a second. You get 5 cards. You get to draw cards 3 times. Maybe 10, 11 cards. I'm in. This sounds like fun. I kind of want to try this game. If only there was an easy place to play it. There's no... Oh, where am I? You can't... I see... I want to play triple draw now, but I can't play 8 game because I want to play... I just want to play the 1 game. I don't want to play all...
You can this game. You can play.
Come on over, huh? You're like the triple draw ambassador. Is this how I sound when I talk about PLO? Holy shit, man. I love it. I mean, yeah. I've never played Deuce of Seven, guys. It's just it's just not a game that's commonly played. Like, you know, you don't have friends that are like, hey, want to play Deuce to Seven?
It's a game always been popular among high stakes player, like, because it's, I don't know why, like, you don't see that low stakes much, but it's so popular. Draw games are always very popular in the high stakes. And actually, it's a very easy game to learn, you know. That's why I taught my wife at first. I didn't taught her No Limit Hold'em, I taught her Deuce to Seven, because it's so much easier to learn. It's very basic. You get five cards and you have to get the lowest card as possible, changing three times. It's very straightforward game.
Actually, you're right. It is pretty easy to learn. Monaco Special is the new Mexican Straight. That's a good, yeah, we gotta add Monaco Special to our dictionary here. Monaco Special, when you donate money and make a terrible fucking play, the Monaco Special, perfect. Yeah. I know what it is, right? You're donating money and you're making a very atrocious play.
Yeah, it's fun. The Monaco Special was, you know, like showing he's a cool guy and he can change five cards.
Can you imagine you and Gus Hansen going out meeting women? I can't. That would be like, I would pay a lot of money just to watch that happen. I would just like.
Yeah, I think we do have different look and different style.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. You've always heard Gus is kind of this like big late. I mean, this was back in what, 2000? He's like, he's so old school, man. When did you actually start playing online? When did you start getting into poker?
I started playing in 2007, playing high stakes in 2008, late 2008.
Wait a second. Okay. You started in 2007?
Yeah.
Play high stakes 2008?
Yeah. Well, I don't know what you call high stakes, like 25-50?
Okay, we're going to call that high stakes. We're going to call that high stakes, sure. So, okay. So how do you go from wait a second. How do you start to 25-50 in that period of time?
I don't know. It took me a while to... I got very quickly, I deposited $5, and within a week I had like $500, and basically within 2 months I was playing No Limit 200. Then I stayed there for a while, and then I don't know, I had a very big rush at some point, like, and within 2 months I went from No Limit 400 to No Limit 5K. But really at the time the game was so soft, and also it was at the time I was playing Heads Up, and Heads Up was a total new thing. Like, there was like barely, which seems unbelievable now, but at the time in the lobby, nobody was sitting, you know, on PokerStars or 40. I was sitting alone, and there was no such thing as bumanting. Nobody was sitting, and you would get amazing action from very bad players. So, like, we're having absurd win rate, like 15 BB win rate. So, like, yeah, very quickly, and I had quite an aggressive bankroll management. So, yeah, within a few months, I went from all the way up to No Limit 5K.
So you were playing high stakes cash games and the big bet games up until when?
Well, then I started playing the mixed game in the end of 2009. So, yeah.
And then you met, when did you meet Seb86?
I met him in the summer of 2009, and that's him who introduced me to all the limit game, the mixed game, and stuff like that. Because then he was more a limit player, mainly playing Deuce to Seven, while me, I was a no-limit player guy. And I look at his game and I was like, wow, what are those games? I don't recognize any guy. So obviously I assume they must be bad. You know, like, there's no CTS, there's no Jungleman. Who are those guys? So we team up together, and we both, you know, I taught him my skills, he taught him his skills. And yeah, it didn't work out very well at first. We lost a lot of money. Like, we lost like $500,000 or more. I mean, on my own action, I lost almost $500,000 at the time. We lost a lot of money. We're not playing very well at the beginning and running bad. But by the beginning of 2010, we made it to the hospital.
Pretty sick, man. So 3 years, you're already playing these. I mean, I guess high stakes, you're playing high stakes in like, you know, a year and a half, a year. And then 2 years later, you find out about mixed games. And then 3 years after you start, you're playing some of the highest stakes games that are running basically anywhere online.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was not very hard back in the days. I mean, it's kind of easy saying that now, but really, like, there was so much room to move up. Win rate were really big, so much action. I think the main challenge was more overcoming maybe some fears that you might have about, you know, dealing with big loss or things like that, rather than skill-wise.
So is that something that you just dealt with really well the first time you went through it? Like the first time you went on a few hundred thousand dollar downswing, you just...
Yeah, it wasn't easy. I think I'm not the best at it, but I'm okay to deal with it. I'm always been quite cautious. I always sold a bit of action. I never had all my action in the big game. And even now, I keep selling one. I don't need to, but I feel like I'd rather have a higher happiness CV. Because, you know, it never feels good even now for me if I was half a million on stupid big games. So I'd rather have smaller shares, even though I'm giving away EV. But at least I feel happier in my day-to-day life. You know, I think to me, there's a certain limit. I don't mind losing 100K in a day. But like when the 2K, 4K was running, it was really absurd. I could have lost like over half a million in a day. That's a bit, you know, it's stupid in a way. It's mental limit, but you know, everybody has his mental limit. Mine was the half a million mark or something.
It's interesting you put it that way. I was just thinking about this the other day when, you know, I do something where I'm working with a couple of people, and one of the questions that they asked me was, how do you deal with the emotional toll on you when you move up to take shots? And I was thinking about the question, and I was like, you know what? It seems like when I move up to a stake that's a little bit uncomfortable for me, when I lose, if I lost 10 buy-ins, that's when the emotion starts to hit me. But when I might be playing, you know, if I'm playing 5-10 or playing 3-6, if I lose 20 buy-ins, it's, you know, I mean, whatever, you know, it happens, PLO. But it doesn't really affect me that much. But for some reason, it's like when you cross a certain threshold to you, that's when those emotions really start kicking in and you start getting extra tilted. All of a sudden, it's like affecting you for 6 or 7 hours. And I guess it's different for everyone. Like what, you know, for you, it's, where is it, a couple, 200,000 or 100,000? That's when it just, I don't know, something switches over and then all of a sudden you feel some type of way about it?
Yeah, I mean, everybody's different. For some people, you know, they don't feel comfortable shorting 5-10. You know, I knew a guy, he was playing 2-4 in 2006, making lots of money in 2-4 at the time where he could have moved up and made so much money, and he never moved up higher because he had a mental block in his head. He was like, oh no, I can't play 5-10, it's too much money. I don't like losing like 1,000 in one hand, which is silly. Imagine how much EV he lost, like maybe millions, you know. Just because he had this idea in his head and didn't want to deal with it. I gotta
be honest with you. I'm a little envious of people who can do that, who just can just play one stake for, I mean, just 2-4, just play 2-4 for fucking years and just be okay with it. I mean, I'm sure you have some regrets because you want to move up, but for some reason you just can't. But at the same time,
well, I think at the time that was quite silly. I mean, looking back, like if someone these days would say that would make sense because there's not like that much to chase at higher stakes. But at the time, like, can you imagine the amount of EV he lost by not moving up when he was already crushing 2-4 in 2006? Like, this was the age where you could make millions so easily, and he didn't bother, you know?
Yeah, it's pretty tough. I mean, you know, it's just so much different now too. The landscape's so different, especially at the cash games and.
Yeah, it's so much tougher.
Right, like it's, man, but I'm pretty excited. So you've seen the new website, Run It Once, is going to be starting a poker site. You saw that announcement Phil Galfond made?
Yeah. That's great news, even though I'm a bit like, I mean, I'm sure he's aware of that, that's going to be very hard, because I think the main challenge for any website is to get recreational to deposit, and all his advantages, all his marketing was never being focused on them. So it's like he starts from scratch, from new, and he has to compete with like this huge international company that is poker stars who spend so much money. I was like, I mean, they got Cristiano Ronaldo and Aaron Paul, you know, as a marketing tool. It's like to compete with that, unless they want to spend millions, it's going to be very hard.
Yeah, I think that's the, you know, that's kind of been the thing I've been reading about comments. How are they going to get recreational players? And here's what I'm thinking, and I hope happens, is that most of the professional players, I feel like all the professional players are going to want to support the idea, because it's just PokerStars has kind of been, you know, taking Supernova Elite away, doing all these changes. It's given a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth. And I feel like at this point, assuming the sites run well, professionals are just going to want to support it and they're going to spread the word. And I feel like if professionals are spreading the word and telling people, hey, come play here, I think that's going to be the way that the site can grow.
But anyway, I'm sure, you know, Phil Galfond is a very smart guy, so he's aware of that. I'm saying that, but I'm sure he already knows all of that, and he probably has a plan. He will not start this idea without having some very strong plan about the recreational and all of that. So actually, it's probably, in that sense, based on his background, it's probably good news, because he will not do that without a strong team and a strong plan. So it's probably quite good news.
Yeah, I feel like this would be very good for somebody like you, because if he does attract the professional players, well, that's that means that you'll be able to actually, I mean, I feel like this is really good for the high stakes guys who can't get action or who aren't getting much action and want to play more.
Yeah, that could be good. Also, you could have a game with less rake, maybe in high stakes, because, I mean, I'm not much concerned about that, but it seems for the no limit or PLO guys, like at 5, 10, 10, 20, it's really hard to just battle rakes with how high is the rake. So, like, you can't even play a heads up no limit anymore on stars, right? You can, but like the reg at 5, 10, 10, 20 is so absurd in a game where in this day the edge are really small. So yeah, I think for many regs, that would be quite a good news. For the top regs at least, because they could do more battling.
Yeah, well, I guess it's kind of like you said, if the top regs are there and then if there's more regulars who are going to play, then that brings worse regulars because those guys want a shot take or they see the action running. So it's definitely it's definitely good for the best players for sure.
Well, it's always good for best player, you know, when there's action.
So you're pretty much all in on poker, it sounds like, in your life. That sounds like what your main thing is.
Oh yeah, I'm fully into poker still.
You know, because a lot of the big trend these days is for a lot of guys who've had a lot of success, who've made millions of dollars playing. Now they're looking to get out of poker. They're looking to do something else in poker, or just do something that's not.
I'm thinking about it, but I don't have any plan yet, and I'm still enjoying poker. There's still a lot of EV, a lot of money to be made for me, and I still love the challenge. You know, for me, poker has always been about the intellectual challenge, and still competing at the highest stakes with in tough competition. I still enjoy it. So yeah, I'm still very happy with what I'm doing.
So, do you think if you weren't winning the same amount, or if you were breaking even, or winning small, do you think you'd still really enjoy playing, or do you feel like you'd be more inclined to want to move on at this point in time in your career after you've already been playing for so long and had it as such a focus and had as much success as you've had?
I would probably find it very frustrating because I said I'm quite competitive. So if I would feel I'm not beating or everybody was beating me, I would not be happy about it. Then yeah, but probably be a good time to quit, I guess, because no money and no, I'm not doing well. And feeling like some people are better than me, that would not be a nice feeling, I guess.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because I feel like most people probably would, instead of, you know, because you put in so much work to get so good, and then you're so good, and now all of a sudden, maybe you fall back in with other people. Most people kind of just, instead of trying to get back up there, it seems like most people are just like, well, I've been doing this for so long, I'm probably better off going to spend my time pursuing something else.
Yeah, but also, you know, in those times, it's, everybody's aware, like, the poker is not on the, you know, the economy is going down. Like, we're not, obviously, my EV over the next years is going to go down. There's no, unless maybe the American markets opens up and these games are back in the US or something like that, it's only going to go down. So, yeah, I think it's all about as well opportunity and ideas, you know. For if I want to quit, I need to have a plan. I'm not just going to quit something that I still enjoy or I still make money. If I already have a very strong plan or very strong passion or something I want to do, I could quit right now, maybe, even, but it's not the case. So,
when you think about that in terms of other passions, does that other passion for you require something that would make a similar amount of money or have a similar amount of EV?
That no, it's like not at all about the money. Like, I will be looking for something that I'm just passionate about. I've been fortunate enough to have a lot of money, so it's really not a concern for me anymore. Much. It's more about, something I would feel like I can contribute and that has an impact on society or something like that. Because, you know, as poker players, we do nothing, you know, we just take money from people. So yeah, I'd be happy to have to do something more noble, I guess.
Believe me, that's something I've been asking myself that question for the past couple of years. And yeah, I mean, I feel like poker is a means to get to a point where you can have that impact. So you having success and being able to afford to do anything that you want with your life, that's what poker gives you. So it gives you to that point, then you're able to make a difference or you're able to make an impact, however it is that you want to make an impact on something.
Yeah.
So are you into the reg charity and the...
No, I haven't. It's quite a good idea, actually. But I don't know, it's selfish of me, but I'd rather contribute with my talent, how it would be, rather than just money, like to contribute my time and my work rather than just giving away money. That,
yeah,
I guess it would feel nicer than just giving away money. Like I could theoretically work for the next 10 years without being paid. I would not mind that if the work was meaningful.
Do Do you feel like you're doing anything like that in your life right now in terms of contributing your time to anything?
No. I'm not doing anything in that sense, no.
Well, I guess what can you do, right? You can...
Well, it's really hard, especially if I will do something. I will not do something small. I'll try to have a big view on something, you know. I thought like one of the best way I would probably do that would be maybe joining a startup that has a very interesting project and developing it. I don't know.
I mean, I guess this is why so many people do reg, is because they can still focus on poker, but also contribute to... But they're contributing money, I guess. I mean, you can, there are. I feel like there are some ways you can get more involved with reg in terms of putting your time into something. But yeah, that's if you do want to.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it really makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
Yeah. People in the chat keep wanting to know about Isildur. They keep wanting to know about Isildur. All right, guys, Isildur won. What are your thoughts on Isildur, the young legend himself?
I've been playing him a lot over the last years, because since he started Mixgame, I've been playing him a lot. Actually, it's quite funny, when he started playing, there was quite a strong memory. When he started playing Just to Seven, so he basically didn't know the rules, and he started straight at 1,000, 2,000 limit. Best action I've ever had. It was absurd, like, and he lost half a million within the evening. It was like, I'm not kidding, my wife played better than him at the time. He didn't even know what card to draw. Like, he was like playing without knowing anything, you know? That was just absurd. So yeah, that was my first encounter with Isildur. Then he gave me a lot of action a year later on Fulltilt, and he crushed me hard. I still play him a bit. Like, I don't enjoy much playing him, even though I think I have a slight edge, but the thing with Isildur is I need to be focused so hard to play him, because he has such a strong explosive style. Like, sometimes he's gonna be maybe over folding and then he adjusts and doesn't fold anything. So you always have to be so focused to know where he's going, and you want to exploit that. So it's very tiring. While sometimes I play other guys, it's a bit more chill because they don't change much their strategy, and me neither. So I do play him a bit, but I don't enjoy much playing him his action, just because I find it stressful.
So one year he went from, that goes back. Try the mute thing again.
Sorry?
Try the mute thing again on your end.
All right.
The echo. Echo, 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 echo. Test, test.
Is it good?
A little bit. No. We're live. It happens. Okay. All right. I think we're good. So, 1 year he went from not knowing how to play the game to being able to compete with you at the highest level.
Yeah. I mean, to be fair, first he put a lot of volume. He's very talented, but also Just to Seven is one of the easiest games to learn. Like, there's not that many decisions you have to take. Like, you know, some games are very complex. You get no limit of them, pot limit of mar, or even some other limit game. But Just to Seven, I would say 99% of decisions are really automatic. You don't even have to think. It's very like straightforward. So yeah, it's not one of the fastest games you can learn, I think.
Interesting. So did you play him at other mixed games as well too?
Yeah, I'm still playing now in other games. He's very good at Omar Elo, so I don't give him action there. But I do play him in the head games. But again, I don't give him that much action usually. Unless I'm really in a good positive mind to play and I'm really focused, because again, I need to be really focused to play. So I usually try to make sure I'm in the right mood.
It's interesting. So you feel like most of the other regulars don't use that same approach, where it's kind of one day they're playing, one day they're folding this percentage in this spot, the other day they're just not folding, one day they're folding all the time.
At least in the mixed game, I can think of most guys are fairly balanced at the play. You know, they don't go extreme. While him, he can really go absurdly extreme in some way, so you really want to exploit that. But again, he's very smart, so he can switch very quickly from one way to the other. So that's why he needs so much focus and attention.
So who are some of the guys you play with, you like to play with now, or that you're playing heads up with the most or shorthanded with the most?
The game, I've been playing a decent amount of Elior, Crazy Elior. Otherwise, you know, there's the guy who are always there, so we always get to play together, shot and deal, like Joizo, Source, Jaren, Jungleman is there quite often. Not the nice thing about mixed game for people who like to battles is it's very hard to guess who has the edge between two regulars because there's so many games. It's very an accurate estimation of your edge in each game. Because first, nobody has sample. Like even me, I've been playing mixed game for so many years, but I can't know my win rate in any of those games. Because either the sample is too small for the year, or I need to look at all my database from the last 6 years, but then it's not really accurate because whatever I was winning 5 years ago, and I was playing different and not the same opponent. So nobody really knows what their win rate are. So that creates a lot more action, I guess. And that's why there's still some action there in the mix.
So how do you think Sauce's game's coming along? Because Sauce, obviously, has been playing mainly mixed games.
Everybody. I think lately he's the biggest winner there. Like I'm not really sure, but he seems to have been crushing really hard.
Wow. Pretty awesome.
The thing is with Sauce, it's like, or do you have a jungle? That's why I don't give them action. It's like, they're just so good at big bet games that it's so hard to make up for that. Because if I play them edge, they're going to crush me for like 15 BB or something absurd like that. So it's pretty hard to make up for that in the limit game. And even if I do, I will still have an overall win rate which will be very small. So yeah, it's quite hard to get. It's fairly hard to get a good win rate in this game. Because the guy always going to be better than you at some game, usually. He's going to be a specialist somewhere. So yeah, it's fairly hard to have a big win rate.
It's interesting. So it sounds like you could. I mean, it sounds like. So I guess in your approach, are you trying to put more time into getting better at maybe the big bet games then? Because
yeah, for example, I did spend a lot of time lately at Heads Up No Limit on them. But the thing, there's just so many things. Like for example, I did get better at that, but sometimes I'm gonna play six max. So then it's again something different. So there's also PLO I need to work on, and then I still need to work on my limit game, you know, because I need to keep stay sharp. So it's hard to put a lot of time in one thing. So it's hard. Also some games are really tough to learn. You know, like PLO, I think it's probably my worst game. It takes so much time to learn. There's so many spots, especially I tend to play short stack. I mean, to buy in short stack, so then. You have to know, for example, in 6 max, every range you should stack off according to the SPR. So that's fairly hard to know. You know, I'm always kind of guessing and spearing around because I don't really know. You know, and the only way to know that, it's very hard to guess. I would have to put a lot of times, you know, with software looking up for equity, knowing exactly how range are. And I did that a bit, but I don't have time to do only that. So that's why I kind of sucks and need to start. At least. Comparing to the top guys like Stoss or Jenga.
It's really interesting. So maybe there's value in, because Nonstop says, ask him about playing 510 heads up no limit Zoom the other day. Is it practicing for Sauce and Jungle?
Who was doing that?
Nonstop's in the chat, Vernon.
Sorry, I didn't know. Which guy did play the 510 Zoom?
He says it's not. His name's Nonstop on YouTube chat. He said he saw you playing 510 Zoom the other day.
Oh, he saw me playing. Yeah. No, that's true. Yeah, I do practice on Zoom or somewhere. Yeah, I did put time to. Yeah, I'm normally playing some, trying to play the 10-20 guys. I heads up once in a while too. But the thing is, it's not the same. Even though they're good, it's one thing to beat or to play the 10-20 guys, but then it's not like playing Source of Jungle, I think. Especially at PLO, like, you know.
I think there would be. I mean, if you play I'm not a big advocate for short stack PLO players, but it would probably be good if you played some Zoom or some 2-5 Zoom and just practiced, I guess, you know, playing that stack size, playing short stack, because you imagine, it's kind of about learning the spots and learning the equities in certain situations.
I've done that a bit actually, but again, it's about time. You know, I don't have an infinite amount of time, and I don't want to spend all my days studying. So. And usually I play 8 different games, so you know I'm gonna study as well all the sports, maybe Stud Hilo or Mahilo or whatever. So
yeah,
I try to split my time, but yeah, I guess I should spend more time on my PLO.
Yeah, I guess it's like if you feel like you're, you know, playing against someone like Bear, like Sauce or Jungle, and those guys are gonna be playing a lot, which I assume they're gonna be playing a lot, then it might, you know, there's some merit like, oh, maybe I should get better at these big bet games. If they're really beating me at these games for that win rate, but at the same time you want to maybe get sharper at these games so you can beat them in these games. Yeah, so exactly. It's kind of this weird little balance.
Ideally I could spend. You want to study nonstop. You at least have an infinite possibility in terms of studying. Like I always have something I can study on, you know. At least that's what as well is nice about playing this game, and that's why I don't get bored. That I don't feel like I'm always doing the same thing. You know, maybe that day I'm gonna look up Stud ILO Sport, and the other day I'm gonna look up No Limit Hold'em or practice that. Or so it's always refreshing. That's probably why I'm not yet bored and I still enjoy poker. Playing all those different games is still very exciting and refreshing.
No, it makes a lot of sense. That's why you'd still have the passion for it, because you can always learn something new. It's like, even when even if you start getting better at two games, in theory, you probably got a little bit worse at this game because you put so much time into this game thinking about it.
Yeah, exactly.
You can kind of circle back and go there.
Yeah.
Interesting. Who do you think are the people like power rankings? I know some people like to give power rankings. Do you have a power rankings list for some of the guys playing the mixed games right now?
Well, as I said, it's very hard to know for sure so it will be very hard to do ranking. I can give you names, but it's the same name I gave you, but like, yeah, of course you will have like Joizo, Charren, Souls, Jungle, Trutera, Isildur, maybe some have forgot, Elior, you know, it's quite a big group of guys who are all like battling and playing the high stakes, and ranking them would be fairly hard. I could have a guess, but it's quite hard. I would probably put Souls on top just because he's fairly decent in all the limit and very strong in big bets. Then it's a bit harder, I guess, to rank.
That's crazy. That's awesome. I mean, I don't think he was even playing mixed games.
Oh, he's been playing for a while, you know. He started I remember playing him in 2010, in 10-game mix.
Oh, so he started playing in 2010?
Yeah. He's been playing for a while. You know?
Really? Interesting. I didn't know he's playing. I thought he was... That's in really... I remember we talked about
this. I mean, it wasn't his main thing at first. He was just like, you know, showing up, playing a bit, and spewing around and leaving. But the more years goes on, the more he was spending time on it, and... But yeah, it's been a while since, like Jungle, you know, they've been playing more than you think, you know, they've been around for a while.
Yeah. It seems like Jungle's been, do you have like a Jungle Man story or a Jungle Man, do you have a Jungle Man impression?
no, actually, yeah, let me see. No, it's a bit embarrassing for him, I'm not going to say it.
I love Jungle Man. Shout out to Jungle Man. I'm sure Jungle's, I don't know if Jungle's watching this. I know most people like to watch the other guys they like to play with, but yeah, I don't think Jungle. I don't know if Jungle watches podcasts. I don't know. He's a fun guy, right? He's a fun guy to play with. Has he ever chatted with you and told you to go fucking kill yourself or something like that, or what?
Yeah, probably. I don't know, but yeah, he might have done. Yeah, I don't remember much, but yeah, his chat can be quite funny. Yeah, it's funny how mad he gets in the chat, like trash talk and go on massive tilt. But his game stayed the same, so. It's kind of disturbing. You would think like his game would go crazy because the chat goes insane in the chat, but yet his game stayed the same. It's quite surprising.
Yeah, I think that's what everyone says. He in the chat, he's telling you that he wants to murder you, but at the same time, his play is, you know, still playing pretty consistently well.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, exactly.
What happened to the light there, Poppy? It was very bright a second ago, and now it literally got pitch black dark there. And like
it's coming.
You guys see that? It like feels like the darkness overtook his room and just like one minute it was light, the next minute it was dark. Let me see what we got in the chat. Let me give a couple of shout outs here real quick. Well, we got a lot of guys out there in the chat. I appreciate all the comments, appreciate all the questions. I will be back later tonight. I'm gonna be going back to back tonight with Doug Polk tonight, 7 PM Eastern. That's gonna be a fun podcast as well. Who we got out there? Hero Value Puppy. What's up, buddy? Aurora Chad. Let me see who else we got out here. Andrew Rivers. What up, Andrew? Remy 76. Mike Jones at Mound LB. Adam Svetlik. Tau 2080. I love you, Joey. I love you too, Puppy. Aurora Chad. Matt Lawrence Essek. Chad Hulsey. Hey, Joey, can I get a shout out? I'm a huge fan, Puppy. Much love, Chad. Much love, kid. Prime Poker. Martko Milanovic. What's up, Poppy? You got a shout outs to give? That's you, Alex. You got a shout out to give?
Sorry?
You have a shout out to give?
What? A shout out to give?
A shout out. Do you want to give a shout out to anybody?
No. No. Is it the traditional thing? You shout out to some of your friends on the podcast?
Sure, or you can shout out a random person if you'd like. I like to hear all other people give shout outs.
Sorry, I don't have anything in mind.
All right, I'm going to try to give a shout out like Alex. Hold on a second. I ain't brought the French accent out in a while. Hold on. I'd like to give a shout out to Chad Hussey in the chat. What's up, Chad? I'm going to I got to work at that a little bit more. I'm trying to do a French accent, but it's so challenging to get it down.
Yeah, I guess. It's too bad my wife isn't there. She's quite good at doing the French accent.
Yeah, I feel like, I assume most of the English people are they good at doing French accents?
Yeah, well, you know, there's so many French people living in
right,
London.
Right, right.
Like, it's an absolute number, so they're used to our accents. And,
yeah. I don't know. Let me, guys in the chat, if you guys got some questions for Alex, now's the time to get them in. Anything you guys want to know, within reason, don't get out of line. Joe Flat says, have you guys talked about the heads-up match? Yes, we talked about the heads-up match already against John Smith. We did talk about that. Let's see what we got in here first. Who we got? What questions do we have? No, he should prep. No, I can't do that. No? Is that covered Montreal? No. You got any traveling plan for the rest of the year, Alex? Or are you going to stay in London?
Yeah. As I said, I'm traveling quite a bit because I got a bit
of Paris.
Mm-hmm. Also, it's very convenient when you live in London to go to Paris, so Sam often go there. And I don't know. I need to look at the program of the EPT. I might be playing one or two. I don't know. Also, I got my honeymoon coming soon. Going to St. Lucia.
You're going to where?
St. Lucia.
Oh, cool. That'll be fun. When are you, what's, it's kind of blending in. What's St. Lucia?
Yeah. It's in the Caribbean. Caribbean? Oh, it's in English. Caribbean?
Yep. This looks GTO for sure. Yeah, that'll be fun.
Yeah.
I guess you'll be able to go hiking there too. It looks like they got a bunch of mountains and stuff.
Yeah, I made sure there was a mountain there.
Are you big into hiking as well too then? Because if you like the bouldering?
Yeah, we stayed there like 10 days, so that would be nice to do something different. Like, I thought at first to go to the Maldives, but I thought, you get bored a bit there. Like, I like to do activities, so in Maldives you can do the diving, but there's, it's fairly quiet otherwise.
Yeah, it's pretty flat there.
Yeah.
Man, this place looks sick, yeah. I feel like there's so many of these really nice, beautiful islands, and I've never been to one of these nice, beautiful islands before. So,
yeah, well, for sure. There's going to be so many. Have you been in Thailand?
Yeah, so what was that like? So you live in Thailand. What year was this?
I lived there in 2009, 2010, I think. And so, life was amazing there. I was at the time, I was like 21. And that's the place to be when you're 21. You go party every day. Everything's cheap. Life is great. Nice weather, nice girls. That was quite a crazy lifestyle at the time.
21 years old, living in Thailand, playing the highest stakes cash games online, having these $500,000, $1 million swings, and living in a. Yeah. Are you living on a beach in Thailand?
No, we had like a villa near the beach. Yeah, not very far. We're like a big group of poker players living together. That was really nice. Really partying every night. Ooh. So yeah, I played a lot hangover those high stakes games in Thailand. Actually, I used to be really good with hangover, when I was 21, like most people, I could handle it so easily. So that was okay, 14 gin and tonic, but I'm fresh the next day.
14 gin and tonics fresh the next day, huh?
Yeah. It's not the kid anymore.
Are you and Seb still best friends? People wanted
to know. Yeah, I know. He was actually my best man at the wedding.
So what happened to him? What's he doing?
So he retired from poker about like 2 years ago. And so now what he's doing is like splitting his time between property business, like he's been buying flats and refurbishing them, renting or selling them. He's doing as well some business angel stuff, investing in startup. He's also doing a bit of sport betting. So he's a bit touching to different kind of stuff. He's a bit everywhere. He's living in Lisbon, between Lisbon and London at the moment. So yeah, it seems he's having a good time. And he was getting a bit bored of poker like 2 years ago. He didn't have any more the motivation to play. So I just quit and felt like looking for something else.
No, I definitely understand where he's coming from with that. Mirlo Roca, I'd like to know what his biggest downswing. I mean, how much? Thanks, Mirlo, for the question.
That has to be 2.5 million.
That's it? Okay, that's pretty bad, yeah.
But I didn't have all my action on that, but that's the size. I don't know how much I had in my action there, maybe a third of it. Yeah, that was a thing. When I played a German, you know, it's always a German story, the dancing. I played a German heads up in Deuce 7, I think it was in 2014, and it didn't go very well. Like, I lost that within a week.
Didn't go well, might be an understatement.
Yeah. That's okay, I had a very good upswing before, so.
Which guy was that? Was it Taklas or one of the other ones?
That was Kagome and Costa.
So 2.5 million.
Losing every day, losing nonstop. Yeah, that was almost like 600 big bets in a row or something like that.
So how do you begin? Did you make it back against him, or did you make it back playing against other players?
Yeah, I mean, as I said, I had a huge upswing early on. So like a really absolute upswing. I had absurd win rates. Like before the few months earlier, there's been a lot of action at the 2K, 4K. Mixed game, I used to say, and I had like a huge upswing. So even with that loss, I was still up a lot over the year. So that was alright.
2.5 million, huh? 2.5 million. Yeah, a lot of you guys out there in the chat know how it feels. Lose 2.5. It's got to be.
Yeah. Well, that's why you sell action. So it feels better.
I guess. I mean, shit. That's still. I mean, I feel like being able to recover from that mentally is so is so important.
Well, that was okay. That was easy to deal with because this was in 2014. I already had, you know, I have a huge bankroll, so it's all right. Like the hardest downswing were definitely when I started poker. Like there was a time when I, like 2008, before my massive upswing leading to 25-50, I was playing 2-4, and I lost 70% of my bankroll, which was like 12,000 at the time or something. And that was much the hardest ever because that was all I had. And in terms of my bankroll, it was huge. 70% of my bankroll, it was absolutely. Yeah, that was a much stronger hit to me than this downswing was really smooth, actually. It was okay.
This downswing is very small, 2.5 million. Okay. Yeah, I feel okay.
I mean, it's all relative, you know, it's not about a number. It's about, and again, I didn't have all my action there. Like, again, as I said, I was up for the year even after that. So.
How much was this upswing, dude? Wait a second. How much was the upswing? For fuck's sake.
Well, it's 2K, 4K. You know, it got to go quickly. And I was winning all the time, every session. So.
How long was this? Did this winning streak last? Like 3 years?
No, that was just in 2014.
Oh, okay.
I think. I'm not saying.
What's the biggest upswing you've been on then?
Well, I had actually a month, that was when we, you know, I told you I was taking a lot of shots at nosebleed, always losing. And then when it worked, I had, in 1 month, I won over 2 million, I think. I forgot how much. But I had a few times, yeah, also another time I got like, 1 million in a month as well. It was quite silly. I had like only, actually the story is interesting. That was at the time, just after Black Friday, I got my account frozen because I played after Black Friday. On PokerStars from the US.
Oh no, uh-oh.
So they froze my account, and by the way, they took me like $30,000 because when I was there, I won $40,000 during the summer in Vegas online, and when they froze my account, they took as well all my winning, so I got off $30,000. But anyway, when I got back my account, I got banned for like 3 months, and when I got back my account, I only had like 70K in the account or something. And I had a massive upside upswing. I'm like, yeah, within a month, I made it. I won like a million. We weren't even playing that big. Like, just absurdly, like, the biggest run good ever. Like, that's probably what it feels like for the guys who win like 2 tournaments in a row. I guess I got that in cash game, like, winning all the time. And that was absurd. I was playing like even 10-20, you know, like, I had like session at 10-20 where I would win like 20,000. And this wasn't Piero. I mean, this couldn't happen in Piero because it swings. That wasn't Piero, that was limits. So that's absurd. And yeah, it's crazy, yeah.
So I guess do you miss those times? Because I feel like those swings now aren't really. I don't think those are happening anymore. With
no, because the games are much smaller now. 1K, 2K barely ever runs, and now it's 4-8. I could still. There's still some big game running sometimes when people cross book, but I'm definitely on the niche side. I don't take much action. Like I barely ever play more than for 1K, 2K on my action. So, and there's not much running. So no, like. I guess unless some big names start again to make a lot of game rounds, it's very unlikely that there will be a big swing again.
Do you miss that? So that's somewhere in you. Do you feel like you sort
No, not really. I'm not. I'm not a gambler. I don't like swings. I never play in casino. I don't like I don't, I'm not a gambler. Well, for me, the challenge, the pleasure is more that playing good poker rather than the swing. So I don't really miss it now. And the money I'm still playing now is still like still fairly good amount of money. Like it's still like real swing, so it's still significant enough. Like I could maybe not play for like I don't know 2-4. I could not play at 2-4, but playing at a 400-800 mixed limit is still very stimulating, obviously.
Do you spend money on anything? Is there something that you like to do or spend money on traveling or experiences?
Yeah, I think the only money I spew on is it's a little spew on travel. I usually go business offers, but I mean that's quite normal, I guess. Or a bit wine. I spend a bit of money on wine. Like actually the night where we won, we said $500,000. No, maybe it wasn't that much. I forgot. But you know the night where Isildur started playing used to 7 at 1K2K, I just gave off a lot of money. We spew like a 1500 bottle of wine. So that's reasonable, I guess, but I don't know.
So you're not very spewy.
Yeah, I mean, it's so relative, I guess. I mean, a 1500 bottle of wine is quite spewy in my, I think.
That's like a less than a big, it's like a small blind.
Yeah, of course, but compared to real money, I mean, or what can you do more to spew your money? Like, I guess the best way to spew money is in club, I guess, but
nah.
I'm not very spewy for sure.
Yeah, you don't sound very spewy at all. Probably, I mean, that's probably a good thing. I guess then I guess the money can't be the motivator then. I mean, if you're not really spending much money, if you don't really have these big desires to spend money on things now, it's just mainly about the challenge. It's about the enjoyment of playing.
I don't know, again, like I spend money on like property, like, but again, it's not really spew, but I have like a nice villa, you know, I can spend time there making it nice. The thing, I don't take much pleasure for. What would be a big spew? I don't know. Like, throwing away money in a party like a retard and spending $100K in the party in an evening like that.
You could buy a yacht. Like Jeans 89 bought a yacht in Finland.
A yacht in Finland?
He's got a yacht. Him and the most famous Finnish rapper, I believe, they bought a yacht and you could take the yacht up to the nightclub and that's
wow. That sounds good. But it's not that much of a spew. It's you can still sell it back, or you know, it's not like for me a real spew is spending like $100K in a party. That's like real spew, you know.
$100K on a party?
Yeah.
What kind of party are you having for $100,000? It'd be a sick party.
That would be a Phil Ivey's party. I don't know. You know, or that's a spew. I would think.
Yeah, it'd be a spew for sure. people are asking about Ru Kao. Now I remember the name. I think I played with him a bit, but I don't remember much.
Yeah, he's a good friend of mine. He's Piero. I used to crush Piero really hard in like 2010. Like, I used to play anyone and crush everybody for absurd win rate. He also ran really bad. He had like absurd graph. He still had a huge win rate, but like was under EV and absurd amount, like 250 buy-in or something. But now he doesn't play online anymore almost. He just plays live in Macau.
Ru Kao. What is this? Is that his real name?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Yeah, I remember playing online. Do you ever play the Macau games at all? You ever go over there?
No, I don't play there. Yeah, I've been there like once, but basically when my friend started going there to play, that's where I met my wife Lucy. So I was spending more time in London, so I didn't pick the train. And also for me, the action was still really good online, so I didn't feel like, you know, doing the traveling there, because I mean the lifestyle there I don't think is great. Like it's kind of weird. It's not a real city. Like, I mean, I don't know it that well, but from what I've seen, it's a bit more like Vegas style, you know, this big casino and everything's expensive. It's kind of weird.
Yeah, I've heard it is pretty weird there. I mean, the people, it seems like people get trapped. They kind of stuck over there. They end up staying there for 6 months, a year, sometimes even longer, and their whole entire life becomes Macauian strippers and escort bars and fucking playing live poker there, it seems like.
Yeah. Also, there you can spew a lot if you want. Lifestyle is expensive there. If you want to spew, you can spew there.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess it's a good question. What can you spew on? I guess it's just by, you know, staying in expensive hotels for extended periods of time, you know, taking a lot of trips, buying first-class plane tickets, and then all this, you know, 50K goes fast, 100K goes fast doing that.
Yeah, it does, yeah. That's what I was saying. Even for restaurant, the only way to spend a lot of money in restaurant really is the wine, you know. It's never going to cost... There's a cap, you know, you can't spend that much in a restaurant unless you got crazy wines.
Right. And even the most expensive ones, even the most, the 25 course little meals that are $1,200, I mean, comparatively to other things, I mean, that's a lot of money, but compared to other things you can spend money on, it's really not too much here. Let me take a couple questions more from the chat. We'll let you get out of here. Let me see who else. You can spew on crack. Yes, Ross, you can spew on crack. That you correct. Jesus Christ. Yes. Yes, for sure. Let's see. Did Alex get the most? Okay, that's a bad question. I don't even know what that says. Did you meet any Ross, your questions are terrible, dude. Jesus fucking Christ, buddy. Meet any ladyboys in Thailand? I mean, it's a good question.
Well, that's a good question, actually, you know?
I mean, we used to talk about ladyboys a little more on the podcast. Now we professionalized it up a tiny bit. But yeah, do you have any ladyboy stories from Thailand?
Well, I can't tell you anymore.
You can't see me?
Oh, I can see you now. I think there's been a censorship because we talk about ladyboy.
I mean, I don't know. I think they like. Did you meet ladyboys in there in Thailand?
Well, you know, that's actually the only challenge when you go out in Thailand. You know, bringing back girls is so easy, but the challenge is to make sure that it's not ladyboys. You know, that's fairly common.
So walk me through that. What's the technique? What's the strategy in terms of figuring out if a girl in Thailand is a ladyboy?
Because you know they have like wide shoulders or they're quite ugly, and you can see the male pattern, but sometimes it's very hard, and the only way to see it would be like by the voice, or yeah, can be tricky sometimes.
Do you think you've ever went?
I got caught once.
Define got caught.
I mean, like, I brought back a lady boy thinking he was a girl.
And you found out.
I found out after. Yeah.
I heard some of them got really good. They get good surgery done. You don't actually even know.
There was no surgery there, so that was kind of obvious. But sometimes, I mean, some of them are. It's very rare, but some of them you cannot. Actually, that night when I brought back that ladyboy, I was with a few Thai girls, and they didn't spot her as well. Like it was impossible to see. She was really perfectly looking. You know, you could not guess. Most of the time, it's obvious, but sometimes. Well, I have to say, also usually it's in a club when you're quite drunk, so that doesn't help. But it's sometimes it can be fairly hard to see, in rare occasions.
Yeah, I feel like proper strategy would be like, hey, are you a man? And then they say no, and then you just like grab them by their junk and just fucking grab hold and see if they are or not.
Yeah.
I feel like that could work. Give her the reach around. Yeah, or maybe not. Okay, no, I'm kidding. Not grab so aggressively. You want to go a little soft, subtle, work your way up from the chest, work your way down a little bit. You're drinking, you're laughing, you're taking a shot while you do it. And then, I don't know, I'm thinking, I've never been to Thailand. I don't know how the ladyboy scene is there. So it's I've only heard stories. Let's put it like that.
Yeah.
Guys, give me one last question in the chat, and then we're going to wrap it up here. Fun about the chest. How'd you find your experience with the Winamax crew? That's actually a good question. How do you find your experience with the Winamax crew?
That was quite nice. They have a lot of help, Winamax, you know, from like outside. Like they have a guy, for example, in the team, he's a coach who helps with like, he comes from a very strong sport background, he relates you with like concentration or different things, mental, that you as a poker player, you might not have thought about it. Mm-hmm. So that was quite helpful. Also, what was interesting for me as well in the team, they're all like fairly like live player for the most part and with a very exploitive approach from tournaments. So it's good to understand deeply how some of your opponent thinks, you know, the way they approach the game. So in that sense, it was quite interesting to see. And it's the same for them, I guess, seeing how I would define myself more as a GTO player. So to see more of my balanced approach, well, it was quite constructive to, you know, to meet different style of people.
Well, I guess that's the merit for just getting more poker friends, is to be able to talk poker with them and sort of learn from them, really.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. But especially there, usually, you know, you get friends with people from more closer background to you. Like those some of them are really live tournament. I mean, they're quite different. I'm an online cash game player. Those guys were like live tourney players. So yeah, it's a bit different. It was quite an interesting experience.
Who's the most well-known French person, French poker player?
Elky.
Oh, obviously, fucking Elky, Jesus Christ. Okay, I'm fishing out, but. There's someone are not Elky. Besides, Elky's like kind of he's this mythical legend. And there's another guy I'm thinking about. I was trying to. He's sponsored by Winamax too.
Oh, maybe you're thinking of. He's not French. Belgium. David Kitai, maybe.
He's okay, quite well. You got to say that name one more time.
David Kitai.
Yes, that's the guy. Yeah.
He speaks French. He's actually Belgium, but Yeah, he's very well known. He has some crazy video of him on YouTube. You can look it up, where he's like soul reading people, making absurd play, but he's great, yes. You know, making some insane hero code. Yeah, he has some amazing live read.
Do you watch any poker content at all? Are you on Twitch or do you watch any YouTube stuff at all?
I've watched a few of your podcasts. Otherwise, no, I don't follow much poker really. Like, I just, no, not much. I don't get much interest from tournament usually, and all the content is for tournament people usually. Like, it's all around tournament, so no, not much.
What kind of cash game content would you like to watch?
I don't know. I guess you've done that. I haven't looked at it, but like looking for like high stakes hand and commentating, or you know, doing kind of what they do on 2+2, but making the comments over it. You know, there's a high stakes trade where they post right. some hand. And you know, I don't know, making a podcast or something about that, where you go through the hands and comment them with like someone else, or that could look good. At least in my opinion, as a high stakes player, it's fun to get to see the hands from other high stakes player with some background around it.
Yeah, interesting. I'm gonna put that down here. I gotta show the mixed game players a little bit of love sometime. I know the mixed game players, they don't have any, like PLO, like when I first started in the podcast, there was no PLO content and that was it. Mixed game players literally have no content at all. You guys got absolutely nothing being made.
It's a smaller market, you know, like there's how many no-limit and PLO players for mixed game player, you know, it's just a small community and most of them are actually high stakes player. I mean, maybe not, but it's fairly small group, I think, so. And usually those guys, anyway, they come from no-limit or PLO background, so they can still relate to your PLO content.
Yeah. Yeah, I wish there's more PLO content. It's such a... But I mean, yeah, I understand, you know, there's as you mentioned, even PLO, it's small compared to no-limit. Like, no-limit, there's...
Yeah, well, I think for the mainstream, it's not good PLO or museum. It's too complicated from outside view, and it's not what you see in the movie and stuff, so I guess... That's why you always gonna have more non-limit of them stuff.
Yeah, I feel like some of the mixed games would be popular. 7-card stud. I mean, that's a game that goes back. People play that around the kitchen table with their family.
Yeah, I agree. It's kind of sad. There's so many games in Asia that would be so popular if people would give a try, like Badugi or non-limit single draw. Or those games are really great, but most people never give a try, so they don't know about it. But they would love it. It's a lot of fun, a lot of action, and it's very different from no-limit, you know, you get to do something different from all of them, and it's nice, it's refreshing, and yeah, more people should give it a try.
Alex, I got an idea. You're going to love it. You stream mixed games on Twitch. Give them a taste of what it's like. You got to open up the door for them, man. You got to show them, give them a little taste of the drug.
What's his name? A guy who do a lot of Twitch, Jason Somerville?
Jason Somerville, yeah.
Yeah, he's new to mixed game, but he's been starting pushing some mixed game content. And Negrano did as well, Daniel.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, when he was playing the Floyd mixed game, he did
that. Yeah, he was doing it, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah, that's good. Daniel should do that more often. It's good for the games, and it's good for his for mixed game.
Yeah, Daniel Negrano playing 400, 800 and streaming it is probably good for the games, correct?
Yeah.
That would probably be good, correct? I definitely think so. But you could stream on Twitch, though, too. That's the thing.
Yeah, but I don't think I will get as much view as Daniel. Like, Daniel Negroni will have a big impact. If he will do that regularly, I think that will really help growing the mixed game. Like, I mean, it's kind of pointless. Like, for the French community, that would be important, but I doubt that that will have any impact worldwide.
I disagree. Yeah. I disagree. I'm just going to tell you I disagree strongly with that. Yeah, I do not agree with that, no. I think you're underestimating the desire to see one of the best players in the entire world who's won, you know, millions of dollars at the game play. I think you're underestimating the appeal of that alone right there.
Yeah. No, I still think Daniel is kind of special. He knows how to, you know, speak to people in a way that will connect to the game, you know. I'm not really good at explaining poker from a very basic level, you know, like my thinking process will not be adjusted to people who are new to the game probably.
Yeah. No, I see what you're saying. I see what you're saying.
Like when I watch Daniel, it's really good for recreational. It's great. Like, or even for people new to those games, it's really good.
Yeah, but he's only done it like one time. He's not going to, you know, like if the option is he does it once or no one does it, theory, I mean, you think about the kind of, I think about you could have an impact on, you know, that's people don't even know the games exist or they're scared to play the game. It's not like you had to stream the highest fucking stakes, but it's an, when you think about what can you personally do to grow mixed games. So you love mixed games. Clearly you love that. When you talk about them, I can tell you get excited, you get pumped up. So it's like, what, how could you personally have an impact? This is what I used to think. How could I personally have an impact on PLO? Like, what can I do? How can I get more people into PLO? And that was the idea I came up with. And it's like, well, what could, you know, what could you do? I mean, it's.
Yeah, you're right, you're right. That could be an option. But then I would have to, I could not play my base game either, but I guess that's fine.
Yeah. Also streaming on, I mean, yeah, I don't know. When, maybe when a max will do sign, I don't know. I'm just thinking, I'm thinking out loud, trying to grow the great combination of games at mixed games. So,
yeah.
Just thinking out loud for you, man. All right, we'll take one more. Last question.
Actually, you know, a great place for people to start is the World Series. It's an amazing place to get started with mixed games because you have tournaments running every day and small buy-in as well. Like you can do 1,500 tournaments in every mixed game buy-in almost. And that's and a fairly soft, so even for someone fully new, you're not giving away much CV and you can get to experience the games. It's really the place if you want to jump in and have some fun and do it while you are the World Series. It's really good.
Hmm. You sure?
Yeah, every day you got a 1,500 tournament. It might be like Studai, then it's Studailo, maybe it's Homa Ilo or 8 Game or Horse. All the time you got so many tournaments in the, during the World Series.
You know these guys, $1,500, a lot of money, these guys out here, man, they're going to the series playing, take a shot in these games.
Obviously, like I said that, depends for who, but at least I'm saying, even if it's a lot of money, they won't give away too much EV because the field is very soft. Like most people don't know what they're doing anyway in those fields. It's not like, even if you're like, even let's say yourself, you go jumping in a game you never played in those tournaments, you put 1,500, you're not going to lose that much of those 1,500, you know, in terms of EV, because they're really soft. If you know the rules before, and that should be okay.
Hmm.
Or you start with 8 game. You know, you crush people in the non-limit tier round, and you get crushed in the limit. But this makes up for it.
We got to work on this. We got to work on this to live this approach to mixed games, my friend. We need a new line for you. That's not going to work. How do you get into mixed games? Try it at the World Series of Poker. It's only $1,500. You hop in. You're not losing much money in terms of EV because everyone's bad. We got to change that approach around. All right, let's go with this one. If you want to try mixed games, you should really check out the games on PokerStars. Play the lower stakes games, kind of get a little better at them. They got some videos on Run at Once. You know, they'll teach you a bit about the different games. And I think that's probably the best option to get into mixed games if you're out there listening to this right now.
Yeah, my idea.
And then after you do that,
you guys should do like Easy Deal. Just jump in the 1K, 2K. It's a good place to learn.
It's not okay. We can't do that one either. It's not going to work. It might work. Listen, actually, that might work on some people, but it's not. That's not going to grow the great combination of games known as mixed games. Try that out. Play online, guys. Play on PokerStars. Watch some videos. Learn how to play. Then next year at the World Series of Poker, you can hop into the $1,500 events. They have a lot of events each day. They got stud high. You don't really lose much because now you've been practicing for the year. All right, I'm working on it.
Even one, I mean, if they've been practicing, they're going to crush it. Like, they're really soft, really. You have to look at the field. And it's funny, when you look at those fields compared to the no-limit event, you know, in the no-limit event, it's only, like, young guys with their hoods and, you know, very serious atmosphere. When you go in those fields, the 1,500, first of all, the average age is, like, 50, 60. I mean, maybe not 60, but it's very old. Like, sometimes even it feels like a senior event. And, yeah, there's many. You really have to see the field. It's very different, really soft.
Okay, we're getting better. Now, see, now that's what you go with right there. That's the lead for mixed games. All right, so also if you want to learn, you watch Jay Carver. He streams mixed games sometimes. There are also these very small stakes tournaments on PokerStars if you like tournaments to play in. There's Play Money. That's an option too. That'll get you in the door. What else we got? Sorry, I'm trying here. I'm trying here. I'm trying to, you can't just say, go play next year in June at the World Series of Poker. It's September right now, man. It's a long time to wait. People are itching right now. They've been listening to this. They're ready to go play.
I mean, that's the sad thing about this game. There's no, I think, during the war yet. You can't play it in live almost ever unless during that time of the year. Like, I think during EPT, like, they only offer, actually, they might offer some mixed game tournaments in EPT, but they're not as, there's very few people. It's not like the World Series is very unique in that for mixed game players. So much opportunities to play all those games in big field.
Yeah, I think EPTs have, I think they have like 375 different tournaments during their stop. So I would assume they'd have some mixed tournaments in there. But
not really. I mean, from last time I look, it's not. There's very few, and they usually either big buy-in, but there's like 10 players in it, so it's kind of silly. Very small buy-in, and still not. I don't know. I don't think they're doing that good. They do some weird mix as well. Like, it's not nearly as good as in the World Series.
What a surprise. What a surprise that is. I guess that's it. But give the people advice. Give them a piece of wisdom from you, Alex. Give them one piece of life advice and one piece of poker advice to go out on here.
Oh, wow. That's some pressure there. Well, for the life advice, when you do something, focus really hard on it. Don't split your attention between everything. And for the poker, I go for... when you see someone you think is good, do something you will not do, ask yourself why and try to understand why he's doing that. Because so often I see guys, you know, even good players, they're like, oh, that guy's doing that, that's weird. You know, they don't go further than that. But I mean, if someone you think, you know, is good, is doing that, there must be a reason for that. And you have to find out why he's doing that. Maybe he's just chewing or he's drunk or whatever. But most of the time, it's probably because you're missing out something.
Well, guys, that was some of the best piece of poker advice that's been given on the podcast yet. And I know that many of you are going to overlook it and forget about it in less than 2 minutes. And that's a sad thing because that is one of the things that helped me the most was just looking at what the better players that I had trouble with that I knew were winning the most money at the PLO games did and figuring out why they're doing it. Why are they three bearing me all the time? What's happening here? How are they beating me in these? How are they beating me in three bet pots so often?
You know, sometimes the first reflex is like, oh, that's bad. You know, you just because of your background or whatever, you think, oh, that's bad. But then you have to think more. Like maybe there's a reason why he's been doing that. You know.
Right. I mean, I think that's like a big thing to just getting better at whatever you're playing is to even what you're doing well. I feel like you think about what you think you're doing well. I mean, maybe you could be doing it better. Maybe you could be. You know, like people get so complacent when they're winning in a spot that they tend to overlook it. And instead of figuring out, like, could I be even doing better, they just sort of skip past it and don't even think about it. When in reality, if you do think about that spot a little bit more.
Yeah, that's why it's good to understand deeply game theory so you can have the right approach. Because otherwise, it's easy to be losing your attention on the right thing and overfocus on something that doesn't matter. And yeah, having a good understanding of game theory in general helps a lot for every game, I think, to get the right work at the right spot.
How easy is that to get for some of the other games, though?
Because when you start in a new game, you might be a bit lost to what you should do, and understanding game theory can help you a lot, knowing that in that spot you're supposed to fall because of that sizing, 50% of your range or whatever, or even for constricting your range, knowing you need this amount of bluff. And forcing yourself then maybe at finding bluff in a spot where usually you might not care, but that's why, I don't know, it feels like, at least for me, I feel like that helps me a lot in general. Even, you know, in the World Series, when I get to play some new game I've never played, I try to approach them from that point of view.
Is anybody, how long are we in this? We're about 2 hours into it. Yeah, I think being able to bluff being able to bluff in spots that you never would have bluffed before was actually like one of my first aha moments when I was playing Nolan Hold'em. Was I turned a hand into a bluff and I was like, wait, I've never thought about turning this hand into a bluff in this spot. And that's sort of, because then you're like, all of a sudden, I mean, because if, okay, even if you just start, if you know, it's not something you do a lot, but having it in your mind, like, oh, maybe I'll turn this into a bluff on the flop or on the turn or later straights, that all of a sudden transforms the way you think about the game. And now you're thinking about things so much differently.
Yeah. And then you also ask yourself, what's the best time to bluff with in that spot? You know, especially, you know, blockers, they do matter in PLO, but in many games, in mixed games, they matter so much because you see so many cards. So that also constricts yourself, your brain a lot based on blockers or reverse blockers because there's a lot to think about because so many cards are seen. Like in stud game, you see so many cards. Raz, deuce to seven, I don't know how many cards you see because you get your own cards, but also in stud, you get all the cards showing. So sometimes you might have seen like a third of the deck by the showdown. So that's a lot of information to take into account.
A lot of blocker possibility happening there.
Yeah, of course. I mean, sometimes, yeah, it can be sick. Like, It's that's what's exciting about those games. There's a lot going on, you know. And for people who like brokers to play around, that these games are good for that.
I did like Omaha 8 Limit for some strange reason.
Yeah, it's different. There's no that game is yeah, it's fun for different reasons. It's a split pot game, so it's a bit weird. I think for some people they will not enjoy it because the frustration of splitting up the game the pot every time.
Mm.
Like, you know, they want to win or lose. They don't like splitting. For me, it's not the most fun, but it's definitely an interesting game.
Yeah. All right, Alex, we'll let you go. Let you get out of here. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy your dinner, my friend. Thank you for joining us on the podcast, man. It was great talking with you, man. I enjoy hearing about the way that you just approach yourself, approach poker, and I can see why you've had a lot of success, my friend. It makes a lot of sense from chatting with you.
That's good.
So, guys, in the chat. I appreciate all the comments, appreciate all the questions. If you want to follow Alex, he's on Twitter at Alex_Luno, correct?
Yes, that's it.
That's it?
Yeah.
Nowhere else. All right, guys, I'm going to be back later tonight. If you're watching this back on replay, much love. Let me know what you think. And be back in 4 hours with Doug Polk. That's it, Alex. Much love, buddy. Thanks for joining me, man.
Bye.
I'll see you later. Take it easy, guys. Peace out. Adios. Much love. See you guys soon.